Hello, boys and girls, and welcome to Missy Lane's Book Nook. I feel like it's been a long while since we've been together, and it's great to see you again. I thought today we'd read stories that went along with this summer's summer reading theme, which is on your mark, get set, read. And when you think about the words on your mark, get set, read, or on your mark, get set, go, you think about racing, don't you? Yeah, and we're having a lot of fun this summer talking about racing and sports and games and overall fitness, healthy bodies, and how we can take better care of our bodies. That's what the focus is all about. So let's start with a classic racing story. You might know this one already. It's called The Hare and the Tortoise, and it's by Alison Murray, this version. And so in this story, the hare, or the rabbit, is very confident. He's very sure of himself. He knows that he's fast and he knows that he's going to win the race. He just knows it. And guess who he's racing? The tortoise or the turtle. And boys and girls, we know that turtles actually move very slowly, don't they? So if you had to pick a winner in a race against the hare and the tortoise, who would you pick? Okay, well, let's see if you're right. Here comes hare. Hello, hare. Hey, hare. Hello. Could you stand still for a minute, please, hare? See, he's so fast, he's going all over the place. Here on this page, it tells you all about the hare. He has ears that are accustomed to the sound of animals cheering. Why do you think they're cheering? Because he always wins, he's so fast. He has a nose that's ready to sniff out another victory. His eyes are sharply focused on the finish line. His head is a little too big, and his whiskers are extra twitchy. He has paws that are used to crossing the finish line in first place, and he has hind legs that are coiled up like springs, ready to leap into action. Meet Hare. Hare can barely stay still for a minute, but he can run through the tickliest grass, rush around rivers and ponds, dash over misty meadows, and he has never been known to resist a carrot. I'm the fastest on the farm. No one can beat me, says Hare. Today, Hare will be racing Tortoise. Has anyone seen Tortoise? Tortoise, where are you? Ah, there she is. Looked like it was just a rock over here, huh? It was actually Tortoise's shell. And there she pops out. And let's learn about the tortoise. Well, it's a tortoise, and when she pulls her head and her feet in, she looks like a rock. Tortoise can stay still for a very long time, but she has never been known to run through the tickliest grass, rush around rivers and ponds, dash over misty meadows. But she will always do her best. I may be slow, but I'll give it a go, Tortoise says with a smile. Let the race begin. All right, so here we go, boys and girls. Make your prediction again. Who do you think's gonna win, Hare or Tortoise? We're gonna keep reading to find out. This is the race course. It kind of shows you where they have to go. So this X is the start, and they have to go around the meadow. Around the duck pond, through the carrot field, around a shady tree, all the way to the farm. That X is the finish. Let's race to the gate, says Hare with a twitch of his whiskers. First one there wins, so that'll be me. We'll see, says Tortoise. When the rooster crows, the race is on. Ready, steady. Oh, Hare is off and running, and he says, bye, see you later. And Tortoise is stuck behind there, and she says, oh, she's probably thinking, he is fast. Tortoise might be a little bit worried, do you think? How is she ever going to beat him? Hare races through the tickliest grass. I'm so fast, I fly past, sings Hare. Tortoise trundles through the tickliest grass. I may be slow, but watch me go, hums Tortoise. Hare is out of the meadow and zipping past the duck pond. I'm so fast, I fly past, sings Hare. Oh dear, Tortoise is not out of the meadow. I may be slow, but watch me go, hums Tortoise. She's moving slowly, but she's trying her best. Hare reaches the carrot field. Remember, Hare can never resist a carrot. I'm so fast. Huh. Carrots, gasps Hare. Tortoise is miles behind, so I'll have time for a few nibbles and a tiny nap under a shady tree. So here, Hare is hungry for a snack, and he figures he has lots and lots of time. So he snacks on some carrots, look at all the nibbled carrots, and he decides to take a nap under a shady tree. Now this would be Tortoise's chance. This is her chance to catch up. Will she do it? But where is Tortoise? Ah, at last she trundles out of the meadow. She tootles around the duck pond. She tiptoes through the carrot field. Just look at her go. And right past Hare, who sleeps on, dreaming of winning races and animals cheering. He's still sleeping. She's going to pass him up. Go, Tortoise. Who are you rooting for, the Hare or the Tortoise? Who do you want to see win? All right, let's discover the ending. Hang on a minute, gasps Hare. Animals cheering. He hears them cheering, and he's stunned. He's like, wait a second. Hare hurries, Hare races, Hare chases. But Tortoise has won by a breath. She beat him, boys and girls. Can you believe it? Hare, you may be fast, says Tortoise, but I walked straight past. Poor Hare. He's not used to losing. Never mind, Hare. You might win next time, says Tortoise. Come on. Let's race to the lettuce patch. Oh, and they're going to start another race, maybe. Who will win this time? I wonder if Hare's learned his lesson and he's not going to take any more naps. Or maybe he'll do the same thing because he'll get hungry and maybe Tortoise will pass him up again. Who knows? But that book kind of teaches us that it's not always the fastest who wins, right? Sometimes slow and steady wins the race. Running is a good form of exercise, boys and girls. There's lots of different forms of exercise, though. Next, we're going to read a story by Nancy Carlson, and it's called Get Up and Go. You are special. We all come in different shapes and sizes, and it doesn't matter if you're tall, short, skinny, or round. Your body is your own, and you need to take care of it. So turn off the TV and get up and go exercise. Exercise is good for all the stuff inside your body, like your heart, your lungs, your bones, and your muscles. You make a muscle at home, boys and girls? Yeah, show me those muscles. You're growing up big and strong, and you have to continue to exercise to keep growing up big and strong. You see, exercise burns up all the junky food that you sometimes eat, like a bag of chips, or a triple chocolate caramel marshmallow cream sundae with extra whipped cream and a cherry on top. Exercise can be exciting, like when you hit a home run, score a goal, or can finally skate backwards. Exercise can help you become a better sport, because sometimes you might strike out, lose the big game, or, oops, fall down. Exercise can help you make new friends, like when you play tag at the park, jump rope at school, or just walk around the neighborhood Exercise can be relaxing, like when you go canoeing or hiking in the woods, or when you help your mom in the garden. Exercise can take you to amazing places, like to the top of a mountain or way down to the bottom of the sea, or to the middle of nowhere. You can even exercise at home. When you're stuck babysitting your little brother, turn up the music and get your heart pumping by dancing. Today, your living room, someday, Broadway. You never know. Exercise can make you pretty sleepy. Whew, so get to bed, because nobody knows what will happen tomorrow when you get up and go exercise. The end. So lots of different forms of exercise that they talked about in this book. We saw the little piggy biking, right? Do you like to ride your bike? I love to ride a bike. And we saw her dancing in her living room. That's my favorite kind of exercise. What else? If some of you play sports like baseball or soccer. I met some kids this week who play deck hockey. Those are all great forms of exercise. But because dancing is my favorite, I'm going to share with you boys and girls a video from GoNoodle.com. GoNoodle is a new website that I discovered that's absolutely awesome because it's free. Mom and Dad can help you set up an account. And it gets you moving at home. You can exercise at home whenever you want to by going to GoNoodle and checking out the dancing videos and the exercise videos. They talk about healthy eating tips, and it's chock full of useful and fun information. So this video from GoNoodle is a dancing video to the song The Best Day of My Life. And I certainly hope you'll get up and dance at home. Enjoy.
Oh, no.
Exercise is important when we talk about taking care of our bodies, but so is healthy eating. Think about what you had for breakfast today, boys and girls. Was it something healthy? Did you have cereal? There are cereals, there are good cereals and there's bad cereals out there. Whenever you cut up a banana and you put banana in your cereal, that's always a good idea. Eggs are healthy. Yogurt is healthy. Are waffles healthy? They can be, because we don't have to put butter and syrup on top. We could top it with fresh, yummy fruit, like strawberries or raspberries or blueberries or even peaches. So waffles can definitely be healthy. Well, in the next story that I'm going to share with you, Woodpecker is dying for a waffle. I mean, he really, really wants a waffle. So let's read it together and find out if he gets what he wants. Woodpecker Wants a Waffle by Steve Breen. One morning, Benny awoke to the best tummy rumbling smell. So off he flew to investigate. W-A-F-F-L-E, he read. What in the world is a waffle? The waffles smelled good. The waffles looked good. The waffles must taste good too, thought Benny. I want waffles, he declared. Look at him looking through the window. He says, it looks delicious. It smells delicious. I want to try one. So Benny politely pecked on the front door. Tap, tap, tap. But instead of waffles, he got the boot. Uh-oh, one of the waitresses kicked him right out the door. Next, he tried to sneak in. Do you see where Benny is? Trying to blend in with the pattern of this lady's dress. He tried to sneak in, but instead of waffles, Benny got swept away. There's that same waitress shooing him out the door again. Benny tried a number of creative disguises, but instead of waffles, he was tossed in the trash. Oh dear, poor Benny. What are you doing? Asked Bunny. I am wishing for waffles, said Benny. The animal started laughing. That is ridiculous, Bunny said. One by one, the other animals chimed in. Raccoons don't eat ravioli. Moose don't eat muffins. Frogs don't eat fries. Owls don't eat oatmeal. Lizards don't eat lasagna. Hawks don't eat hot dogs. Coyotes don't eat cupcakes. Snakes don't eat snow cones. And skunks don't eat scones. Turtles don't eat turnovers. Bears don't eat bagels. And chipmunks don't eat cheeseburgers. And woodpeckers don't eat waffles. They're telling him it just doesn't happen. Give it up. But Benny, he's determined. He's not going to give up. Well, why not? Benny asked. Why not? Why not? The animals grumbled, chirped, croaked, and whispered. They thought and thought and thought and thought. Well, because I said so, said Bunny. Well, I really don't have time for this said so nonsense, Benny said impatiently. Benny got right to work devising a plan to get some waffles. First, I will shoot out of a cannon. Boom! And then moonwalk and break dance, followed by a stand-up comedy act with the hit ground juggling and a Broadway-style finale featuring fireworks. Wow, that's a big to-do just to get a waffle. Benny means business. He really, really wants one. The animals were speechless, though Benny was sure he heard some snickering. See you all tomorrow. Don't be late. So he's telling them to come back for his show, to come back for that big show that he was telling them about that's going to end with fireworks. They don't know what to say. They don't know what to think. The next morning, the animals gathered in the field by the diner to catch Benny's big show. No one was late. No one except Benny. So they all came to watch. But where's Benny? What happened to his show? As the animals waited patiently for Benny to arrive, the waitress in the diner noticed something odd. The customers noticed something strange, too. They're all looking out the window, thinking, what are all those animals doing there? Why are all those animals lined up on the hill? They're curious. Everyone at the diner stepped outside to look at the animals. And that's when Benny made his move. Where's Benny? Do you see him? Right in the door. He's going to get his waffles. So that was his plan all along, boys and girls. He wasn't going to put on a big show. He just told the animals that as a distraction. And it worked because all the customers in the diner went outside to look at the animals. And that's when Woodpecker could sneak in the door. Let's see, did he get his waffles? Oh, he sure did. Sweet, says Benny. I think he likes them. I think he likes his waffles. So there's one more story that I want to share with you before I leave you today, boys and girls, and it's about a pickle named Phil. And I like this story because I think it's funny, and I love the pictures, but I also like the message that it tells us. It tells us to never give up on our dreams. Phil Pickle lived in a pickle jar and was meant to share the same fate as all the other pickles he lived with. Next to burger and fries on a plate, Helen Pickle always said. Helen was one of the many pickles floating above Phil's head in the jar. But I want to be an actor, Phil told them all. He'd felt this way ever since he heard two shoppers talking about a movie where a man dressed up like a woman just to get a role in a soap opera. I want to pretend to be different characters with unique and interesting lives, Phil explained. Do you know how many other pickle actors there are out there? None. Zero. Zilch, one of the sour pickles chimed in. Not even on off-off Broadway, said another. Think what you want, but it just so happens that I have an audition at a casting company in the city at 2:55 today, Phil said. Why not 3 o'clock? Moshi Pickle asked. 2:55 is what my agent said to me. It's very organized in showbiz. Although the sour pickles did not believe him, Phil actually did have an audition that day. It was for a laundry detergent commercial. When Phil arrived, he couldn't believe how many actors were in the waiting area. Like pickles in a jar, he thought to himself, shaking his head. Just like pickles in a jar. Phil recognized one of the actors in the waiting room from his favorite TV crime drama, Miami Heatwave. He was excited to see a real-life celebrity, until he realized that they were both reading for the same part. Huh, how am I going to beat that actor who plays Detective Blake Miller? He thought. I'm in way over my head. I'm out of here. But just as he reached for the doorknob to leave, a man stuck in his head into the audition room and he called, Phil Prickle? Phil Prickle? It's Phil Pickle, not Prickle, Phil Pickle said. It was too late to escape. He followed the man inside. As he walked, he felt like his feet were cement blocks. What was I thinking? He thought to himself. I can't act. I'm nothing but a glorified condiment. When he walked inside the studio, the director and everybody else stared at him quizzically. Then, after a shrug, the director started speaking. Thanks for coming in. Your dialogue is on these cue cards. Amy here will be reading with you. And please, don't ham it up, the director said. I actually go pretty well with ham, Phil said to break the ice. But no one laughed. He felt the need to explain the joke, but thought better of it. Instead, he just cleared his throat. And then the director took a sip of his coffee and a bite of his brownie. With a mouthful of chocolate, he said, Action! When the director opened his mouth, Phil noticed he had some brownie stuck in his teeth. And because it made the director look silly, it made Phil relax a little bit. So Phil took a deep breath and bellowed the first line of dialogue from the script. Martha, bad news! I got mud stains on my favorite shirt, the one I was going to wear to my job interview! Cut! The director shouted. It felt like you were a little too upset. Too dramatic. It's just a mud stain on a shirt. It's not like you had to flush your goldfish down the toilet. Be upset about the stain, but in a more realistic way. Phil listened to the director's feedback and did another take. The director seemed pleased and asked him to try it again. This time, after saying his line, Phil threw his shirt on the floor, something he ad-libbed. Everyone in the room seemed excited, so he kept on going. Phil felt like he was on a roll, but all of a sudden, the director yelled, "Next actor!" Phil was crushed. He felt like he'd been run through a deli slicer. He rushed out of the room as fast as he could, forgetting to thank the panel for this opportunity of an audition. It just didn't matter. He wanted to get back to the comfort of his own pickle juice. When he got back to the jar, he was mobbed by the other pickles, all asking questions about the audition. Did you get the part? How did it go? Did you break a leg? Of course he didn't get the part, one of the sour pickles said. Poor kid was dreaming. I suppose, said Phil, fighting back briny tears. As he looked away from the other pickles, he saw a big pair of googly eyes peering through the jar. At first he thought it was a shopper, but then he realized it was his agent. Elaine, what are you doing here? Asked Phil. I heard back from the casting company, she said. Phil could hear his heart beating. He could also feel the stares of every pickle and every jar in the entire aisle. Some watched so intently that their faces were smushed up against the front of the jars. Look at all the pickles watching, just waiting, wondering if Phil got the commercial job. They decided to go with an actor named Phil Pickle! You just booked a national spot, Elaine exclaimed. Shooting starts next Tuesday. Oh, and before I go, one more thing. Can you tell me where the pasta aisle is? Oh my gosh. So she came back to tell Phil that they want him for the commercial. Phil could be an actor. But Phil couldn't answer. He was too much in shock, as was every other pickle in the jar, except for Henry, who missed the news because he was too busy playing Angry Dills on his phone. Before Phil's agent left the store, she swung by the condiment aisle one more time to tell Phil about an upcoming audition for a car commercial. Well, the script better be good, Phil said as he winked, making clear he only said it in jest. He planned to stay humble despite his success. The news quickly spread, and Phil was the talk of the entire grocery store. All of the pickles were so happy for him, but it was more than that. He became an inspiration to pickles everywhere. And later that week, when Helen Pickle declared her dreams of becoming a professional kickboxer, not even the sour pickles doubted her. Go, Helen! And there are the pickles, discovering their dreams, deciding what they want to be. They don't have to be just a pickle in a pickle jar. Phil taught them that. Phil, who wanted to be an actor. All right, boys and girls, I hope you enjoyed my pickle story, along with all the other stories that we read today on Miss Elaine's Book Nook. And I hope you will race on over soon to the library to see me. Until next time, boys and girls, bye-bye.